Hi everyone, welcome to my channel. My name is Ogbe Edward Munoyo. I'm not going to add the doctor when you have like real doctors. So today I'm not adding doctor to my name. I just call myself Ogbe Edward. And on this channel today, we're having a very special, special person. He's amazing, amazing leader, coach, and for books, she's having book tired.
Plenty was. Hey, continue.
If you don't see, you can't be around her. Serious with your books and God, much amazing. So I will just allow her to do the introduction. All right, so over to you, ma. Yes, introduction.
Okay, which one is the ma? Please, over to you, my colleague. All right, hi everyone. My name is Ruth Paul Ikana. Let's leave the doctor on the side. Well. I am currently a resident doctor in the Department of Public Health at the Federal Medical Center here in Nigeria. Okay, so I guess the fact I said Department of Public Health means I'm doing my residency program. So Edward asked me to jump on this to talk to you guys about the whole public health residency in Nigeria, which I know might be a bit foreign to a couple of people. Trust me, it was foreign to me when I came initially. I was like, public health residency? How does this work? Well, I hope while we're talking and chatting, you guys will get to know more about it. So thank you for having me, Edward. It's a privilege being here.
I'm so excited. Owing to the fact that it's been a long time we spoke, hopefully this is.
I think the last time I saw your face was in 2015.
Oh my days! Let's not carry personal.
Let's not go there.
Let's focus. But I go take.
Let's focus on the channel.
All right. So I want to ask because majorly, this channel focuses more on when we have the medical talk. Focuses more on medicine in Africa, Nigeria specifically now, because that's the reach that I have with the audience. Hopefully we'll spread across and be able to tell more stories. But basically now, most of the bulk of the people who subscribe to this channel are foreign trained medical doctors or doctors in Nigeria who are trying to aka Japa. So I get a lot of those comments and all of those stuff. Emails and DMs. Okay, but let's focus on foreign trained medical students. Before we get to residency, of course you have to have your degree in medicine. So how was it for you, like going abroad to study and then transiting back to the medical system in Nigeria? Just to quick, short, description. And
so, like Edward mentioned earlier, I like book. Back then, no, not anymore. Now, I just want to be a baby girl. Okay, so schooling in Ukraine, foreign trained. I knew why I was there, so I did not joke on my books. I had a whole lot of extra curriculum. I had a life outside school. If I believe in school life balance, but then I made sure my study was a priority. Because I know that irrespective of where I'm going to after Ukraine, what I have, the knowledge I've attained is what really matters. So I studied a lot. So somewhere along the line, I think on my fifth, sixth year, I knew that no matter when I finish or how I finish, I want to go back to Nigeria to start with. I wasn't sure where the final destination was going to be. But I know that at least let me be licensed to practice in my home country. Before anything else. So when I was done in Nigeria, I think that was in my sixth year, I started asking questions. People that have gone home before me. What's up? What do I need to study? What books do I need to read? Can you send me e-copies? I just started making inquiries from there. So I did my studying. And you know, when you're done after your sixth year, there are a whole couple of documentations you need to do before leaving. And then, as at then, we're still doing the normal MDCN 4 months training. So it had already started. So, but I already had a couple of books, so I was studying. So when I came back home that year, I think that was 2016, it was in Zaria. So I moved over to Zaria. My head was down for the 3 months I was there. I was studying. I was jacking. Because now here's the thing. It's not like it's that difficult. No. The difference is that you're coming to the tropics. You're coming to a developing country in the tropics. The diseases that is prevalent here, that we have a lot of here. It's different from what you're doing in Ukraine. In Ukraine, you must have learned about it, but there's no focus. So most of the things you're going to do is going to be centered around it. I don't want to go too much into the clinical aspect of it because I'm talking to students, but I had to make sure I got in touch with what was happening, the reality on ground. And by God's grace, I actually wrote my exam once and I did well, and that was it. So the next thing was house job. Now, here's the trick. You know, most of us are in medical school. I want to be a cardiothoracic surgeon. I want to be a this one. I want to be a that one. You will just... So we are all over the place, yes. And it's nice. Don't get me wrong. It is nice. But one thing you get to learn, most people, while they were in medical school, they knew where, what they wanted to do. And that's what they are doing now. And it's fine. But someone like me, I think in medical school, my colleagues would always say, I loved anatomy. Oh my God, I love the bone. I wanted to have a skull in my room. Like, I love the bone that much. So then during neurosurgery, I really did like neurosurgery. But when I started my house job, I did well. Funny enough, as a neurosurgery intern, I was so good that my consultant that rarely gives applause, the man had to say that you're really, really good, because he saw me in a fresh babe. At least I was still fresh, not like now. Fresh babe, like what would this one? What would this one know and everything? But I was so diligent. I was hardworking. Like, I come to work sometimes 6 a.m. I'm not on call. And I leave work at 9. I'm not on call. Like, my patients got the best. Like, I was really a diligent doctor. So I fell in love with neurosurgery too. Then I went to orthopedic surgery and I fell in love with it as well. So I was thinking, I'm like, wow, surgery. Then I was also thinking the money part, because, well, there's money inside this thing. But this was where I had to sit back a bit as a lady. I realized that these subspecialties, these specialties in general, are dominated by men. And why is that? Your typical resident lives out of his car. Not because he doesn't have a house. But for one, the residency in Nigeria, we have few. Our government is not going to give you the number you want. Let's be real. Let's be realistic. And most times they'll tell you that there's no money. We know this deal now. So most times the residents have to work extra hard, double the time. So when you picture it as a lady, how are you going to do it? Are you going to say, okay, why I'm in my residency training that might take up to 8 years? I won't have a child, or I would leave my husband at home with the child, or so. I think most ladies thought about this, and you don't, throughout in surgery specialty, where I did my house job, there was no single female, not a single female. So while I was there, I looked at it, I'm like, oh, it's okay, so maybe surgery, I'll just put it on the side now. So I decided, okay, maybe internal medicine, cardiology, at least in Ukraine, I had lots of cardiology. They were mostly females. So I went into internal medicine and I saw it. Okay, let me give you a typical example. This Christmas period, right? Who have the ward full, you have lots of patients that want to go home because they don't want to spend Christmas in the hospital, and they went home, and come January they are back again. The same chronic conditions getting worse. I got overwhelmed and I realized at some point that I can't do this. I can't keep treating, they go, they come back, treating. I can't live my life every day. It's going to get to me mentally. And I'm like, for my mental health, I think I should be on the preventive aspects. Let me reach them before they have to come to the hospital. I don't want to treat one individual. I want to treat the population. So I think that was where my passion for public health was like born and started. Like, that was how it just went. And from there, I made some inquiries and we are where we are today.
Oh, that's amazing. It's just more, it's just more like what I think something I'm just learning generally in life. Many times, like, we have so many things, like, we want to do this. But
yes.
If you can just chase one, and then as you keep going, you begin to understand, like, this what I want, this what I like.
Yes.
And it's a very important tip too that you threw there. Like, it's good to have plenty, like, decisions in medical school, but just relax and go how the flow goes. Okay, so I think you already answered the next question I wanted to ask you. How, of course, you chose the residency in public health. So how is public health in Nigeria?
Okay, so this was how I narrowed it down to public health per se. Despite having the fact that I would preventive medicine. So my initial plan was that, okay, maybe I would do a master's in public health. Okay. So one day I remember having a conversation with a friend who schooled in Nigeria. And the person was telling
If I can interrupt, I'm sorry. Can you put a little difference? What's the difference between a master's in public health and a residence in public health?
Okay. So a master's in public health, it's a narrow specialty. You might have epidemiology, you might have a couple of specialties there, but I don't think it goes beyond 3, 4, or 5 specialties. Besides, it takes like a year. The most you can get a master's in public health will just be 2 years. Okay. But a residency in public health now, to get your full fellowship, it's going to take you at least 6 years.
Wow.
And within that time frame, you have a total of about 12 subspecialties.
I see.
Yeah. So an example, now we all love epidemiology, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's one of the subspecialty, biostatistics. If you say, oh, mm-hmm. I don't want to even see people at all, I want to be a data guy, biostatistics. Yeah. And then there's mm-hmm. occupational health that steadily busts my brain. And what do I mean by busts my brain? So there was a time I went for my occupational health junior posting, okay? Mm-hmm. And it was for like 2 months. And guess where your girl was working? I was working in a factory, like in a safety booth with a teacher. I wasn't a doctor for 2 months, please. Like, you get mm-hmm. to work in an occupational health setting.
Mm-hmm.
And then you identify hazard, you're just keeping people safe. And obviously, you, when you're keeping them safe, these big companies, you're keeping them safe, you get the money now. Do you get the money. So, that's a subspecialty. Then there's environmental mm-hmm. health. Think of every component of the environment, from light to water to waste. That's another mm-hmm. subspecialty. And mm-hmm. there's international health, if you decide to go into travel medicine.
Mm-hmm.
If you want mm-hmm. to work in the airport, port services, that one is mm-hmm. there. If you want mm-hmm. to go into family and reproductive health, you want to work with UN, mm-hmm. UNICEF, mm-hmm. this maternal and child care, it's all mm-hmm. there. If you want to work with the school health, it's there. So mm-hmm. there are whole, and then the people like you that don't even want to see the four walls of the hospital at all. And say,
no, we don't want to.
Health, I want to be into health policy. There's a subspecialty, health policy. There's health leadership and management. So there's a mm-hmm. ton of subspecialties under the residency training. And the beautiful part is that while you're in there, within the 6 years, you actually go around all of them and you're vast in all of them as well.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the day, after you pass your membership, which is after like 3 years, you can then go and choose one subspecialty. But still, mm-hmm. as a public health trained physician, you can mm-hmm. work in any of those specialties. So it's way different. Plus the side of the clinical exposure you get as well.
Yes. I'm so amazed. Like, it's just like I was in awe. Like, you were taking me to that part.
That was how I was when I found out about it. And I'm like, what? I'm like, it's almost like, okay, wait, let me get you the curriculum. I actually took the curriculum. I took out time. I read it for like 2 days. I'm like, no, I said, you know what, get me materials. This is what I'm going into. And that was it.
It's so amazing that I'm so excited that young people get to hear this, because I have a certain level of audience of people who actually say that I don't want to study, I don't think I love medicine anymore. And it's I feel like it's not true. I feel it's lack of knowledge. I'm not so sure.
Yes. Because
all these things you have explained still falls under being a medical doctor.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And you get paid as a medical doctor in any of those fields you're working, any of those ministries, mm-hmm. you're paid as a mm-hmm. medical doctor.
Mm-hmm. And so I just want to, because I've had parents write me, and mm-hmm. I've had people also tell me, my father sent me this your video to watch. So parents, we all need to be more educated, and that's what I want this channel to be. I wish I had more information to be more educated that medicine doesn't mean, I think people, when they think medicine, just take surgery,
treat patients. No.
Yes, patient.
No. The doctor of the future will need to treat so many patients, actually. So mm-hmm. that's what mm-hmm. we're aiming out. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. 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 Great. So it's good. You could go into tech and all of all those things, but let's let it be there. So if you like factory, you know, you just keep moving and everyone will just be calling you dog, dog, mm-hmm, dog, dog. Mm-hmm. You know, and you just be moving with your boots and everything.
Yeah.
It's really amazing. It's really amazing. So how lucrative is it, like money-wise? I know you've mentioned a little bit.
Okay.
In Nigeria.
So,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
All right, in Nigeria. Now, here's the deal. Depending on the subspecialty you pick, and funny enough, each one is lucrative. Let's start mm-hmm. with epidemiology, biostatistics. We just mm-hmm. had a pandemic.
Yeah.
And there was, you know, when there's a pandemic, all of a sudden, the people start opening their purses, because it's the person that is alive that will spend the money.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. So, and when things like this happen, it's actually the public health specialists that are being called upon. What can we do?
Mm-hmm.
Different aspect. What can we do? Those in the biostatistics, what are the data we're getting? How can we make projections with this data? And people mm-hmm. are getting paid for what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand? Mm-hmm. So all mm-hmm. of these specialties are actually very lucrative. Occupational health is very, very lucrative. I think people are looking at that, especially the guys, they are looking at it because they love the whole feel of being outside the clinical setting. Is very lucrative. Maternal and child health is very lucrative. Come on, look at Nigeria, for example. Now, mothers and their children make over 70% of the population. and say you're a public health physician and UNICEF, let me just give you a very simple example. UNICEF is coming and they want to launch a program and you're the public health physician on the ground and you are a grassroots public health physician. So you're working with them, you're liaising with them, you're enjoying your job and you're getting paid for it. Unlike the typical Nigerian that wants you to do something out of goodwill. These people don't expect you to do it out of goodwill. You're bringing in your knowledge, so you will be paid for it. It's actually a very lucrative specialty outside the hospital. Do you understand? But if you still decide to be within the hospital, just like what we do now, I work in a federal medical center, so my training is different from the person in the teaching hospital because we tend to add a bit of clinical medicine into ours. Let me give you an example now. Right now, we are having various, we're having the pandemic. We're also having various outbreaks. You know, in Nigeria, this is Lassa fever season. So it happens in the dry season, basically. You know, it's caused by the rats. The rats carry virus. So the rats, when it's dry season, the rats come out to play and so basically what we do in my center is that whenever there's any case of suspected infectious disease, they call the public health physician, we set up things in place to protect both the patient and the healthcare worker. So you could decide as a public health physician that okay, after I'm done with my training, I don't want to leave the hospital setting. Sure, I won't be the one doing surgery, cutting babies and all of that, but you're going to prevent infectious disease from escalating, not just within your hospital, but in the community as well. So it could still be a bit clinical, but without getting core clinical. So with it, you could decide travel medicine. Oh, okay, you know what? I want to just go open up a center in one of these. Anywhere. You could be in Asaba, it could be in Lagos, Abuja, and it'd be a travel medicine hospital. You have everybody that is traveling come through you. You prepare them, pre-post. And even when people come into the country, foreigners come into the country, this is the tropics. They know of the disease of the tropics and how dangerous it can actually be to them. So when they come, you place them on prophylaxis. You make sure they're on prophylaxis before they come. While they are here, you're monitoring them. It's actually a lucrative sector. So basically, every subspecialty public health is lucrative.
Okay.
It's lucrative, yes.
Great. I'm a medical student now, for example. I'm in medical school and I'm like, I know you said we should like try our hands on like or allow ourselves dream. And I'm thinking like, the way you're talking about this thing, like I want to be like you, like I want to make money. I want to travel medicine. How should I be? How should I go about my medical school with hope of specializing in public health after, especially in Africa?
Okay. So what you should do, things change. So when, as a medical student, make sure you get everything right. Things change. So get your grades right, graduate properly. And after you're done, you do your house job. Once you're done with your house job, you could actually start writing your prime exam, but house job can be a bit tedious. So I always tell them, after your house job, you could chill. After your house job, while you're doing your NYSC, National Youth Service Corps, while you're doing that, that 1 year, use it to get materials for public health. They, if they reach out to you, I can always send materials by mail, tell you what you need to read, tell you the groups you need to join. So you just pass it one time. So once you pass your primaries in public health, now there can be a bit of confusion. Some people refer to it as community health. That's the West African College. It's called community health. That's West African College or West African countries. Okay. Then in Nigeria, National College, they call it National College of Physicians, they call it public health. Do you understand? These are the two colleges that govern the specialties. So you read your materials, you go and you write your exam. After writing the exam, now you've passed, you have your results at hand. The next thing now is to secure a spot for residency. Some of the challenges we have in this country, I would always say, is unemployment. Most times they always put an embargo when the federal government feels like, okay, we don't have money to start paying new residents, because normally, let's be real, normally there's supposed to be a new set of residents every year, so that as the first year's resident becomes second year resident, you'll be new first year resident. But that's not how it is in Nigeria. You have a department, there are third year residents, but no first or second year residents. Do you understand? Even currently now, I'm a second year resident, but there are no first year residents. And it doesn't seem like there'll be anyone in the future anytime soon. So but you just have it handy, and it might just for me, I think when I was ready, I waited a while. That's the truth. After my NYSC, I had my primaries, but I waited a while. But I was lucky enough that I told God, I said, okay, this is what I want. But for the meantime, what job, what am I going to do? I didn't just, at that point, I think I was just all out of clinical medicine. So I knew I am good enough to work as a clinical physician. But then I would not enjoy it. I don't want to wake up in the morning and be sad about going to work. Mm-hmm. So God gave me a place that was a primary care center, but then they were into lifestyle medicine.
Oh, lifestyle. So,
that was just amazing. So just I was a little, basically
just a little light. What's lifestyle medicine?
Okay, lifestyle medicine is an aspect of medicine that deals with managing chronic conditions using lifestyle methods.
Great.
And this lifestyle method includes sleep, fitness, changing habits, just a whole lot of lifestyle methods. So basically, you're not taking medicine to cure a disease. You're bringing about lifestyle changes to cure those diseases. Because come to think about it, most of these chronic conditions we have now, mm-hmm. they are as a result of lifestyle choices.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand? Mm-hmm. Look at type 2 diabetes.
Yes, adult onset diabetes.
Yes, yeah. Lifestyle choices. Yeah. Okay, most cases of, okay, we know that hypertension, they say, okay, this genetic is essential. But we notice that for some people, just by mm-hmm. losing weight, cutting out certain things from their diet, their blood mm-hmm. pressure starts becoming normal.
Mm-hmm.
People
mm-hmm.
having increase in their cholesterol, hypercholesterolemia, just mm-hmm. by changing their diet, physical activity, they stop having needs for their statins.
Mm-hmm. And someone who is like into like maybe baking or cooking could incorporate that into apart from just giving this like treatment choices, lifestyle changes,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
you could also make money from actually preparing meal plans and giving. They will actually, you can, I'm thinking
that was what my facility, oh you don't even know the half of it. That was what my facility was into. In fact, my boss I worked with, she, her specialty on the lifestyle medicine was sleep. So she mm-hmm. even had a sleep clinic. You'd be surprised mm-hmm. how people have sleep disorders. And we mm-hmm. often say, oh, please, Nigeria is hard, so we cannot sleep. But my dear, you do have a sleep disorder.
Mm-hmm.
And you know,
mm-hmm.
once you can't sleep, it affects your growth hormones. You start adding weight, you start becoming hypertensive, a whole lot of issues. So mm-hmm. lifestyle medicine. So I actually enjoyed my time there. I was there all the while till mm-hmm. I started residency. So it was a win-win for me. It was a win-win. Okay. So what I would advise people to do is, while you're studying in this country, as much as we say, just put a whole lot of things in God's hands.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are a whole lot you can change. But make sure before you put it in God's hands, you're doing your best. Study.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Pass. So that when you're mm-hmm. meeting anybody and say, okay, I want to do residency here, I'm coming to submit my application, you should come with your package complete. All mm-hmm. your documents complete. If you're talking mm-hmm. to someone that, oh yeah, I want to go to this particular health center, this teaching hospital, I want to mm-hmm. work there, you should make sure you mm-hmm. have everything that is needed. Oh, can you recommend mm-hmm. me? I have everything that is needed. Okay, mm-hmm. so that's the way. You just get your primaries after your NYSC, after your house job, you get your primaries and you apply in the specialty mm-hmm. you need to be in. I enjoy it. Currently I'm doing what they call a rural posting.
Mm-hmm.
So a rural person is basically, okay, now you prove to us that you can be a city doctor. Let's say one NGO from the abroad come to you and say, okay, mm-hmm. you want to go, because it's not really the Lagosians when they are coming in and they want to do this whole sweep out malaria. It's not really the people in VI they need to go sweep out malarias from.
Sure.
It's those people mm-hmm. in the core villages that you mm-hmm. go there, they don't even have nets on their mm-hmm. windows, they are stagnant mm-hmm. water, the environment is dirty. Those are the mm-hmm. people that will take the intervention to. So public health physician that has been outside, how are you going to make this program work in this locality?
Mm-hmm.
So that's
mm-hmm.
what my posting currently is about. I'm working in a rural setting, you know, the kind of setting that they've not had lights forever. Mm-hmm. Wow, that's interesting. So I'm working there, and you know, it's usual, as usual, when you get to, you have to go meet the decision makers. In this case,
the Igwe,
yes.
The Igwe and all those
yes.
people.
Yes, you have to go pay homage and then you interact with them. Oh, of course, my doctor, you have come.
Doctor.
Yes, you have come. So you ask them what you have already, maybe by the time you're coming, you're already sizing one problem here. This is a problem. But you discuss with them, what is the problem, sir? What have your people been complaining? Is it that some people that you are in this my community, people are always coming down with vomiting still there? You'll be like, okay. So this has to be with what they are taking in, what is happening. So you discuss with them, you start making changes where you need. So you need to go and meet them and say, okay, this is what we'll need to effect this change. You educate the community. So for the period you're there, you're trying to tell, as you're training, you're trying to say, okay, I can handle community at the grassroots and I can implement health changes. And when it is necessary, I can cascade it all the way to the governor, to the president as need be. Do you understand? So it's a beautiful and a vast training. Wow. At some point, I even went to Lagos for obviously the fresh one, international health posting. So I was in Lagos, mm-hmm. chilling. Mm-hmm. Yeah, as much mm-hmm. as you're chilling, you still come to the village and chill as well. So
yes,
it's amazing. It's amazing. It's amazing. Wow.
I'm seeing a lot of people asking you questions from this. I'm just going to link your Instagram handle down below. I always beg people, please. They are doctors. They are busy. So mm-hmm. you just have to. You have to be patient. Somebody wrote someone that I featured on this channel. The person did not reply, African. And then the person came to write me, the doctor. I'm like,
is it the doctor is like,
busy. I'm like, just because he came to do, you think because he came to do YouTube video with me, you yeah. think he's just sitting there pressing phone, answering any message.
No, people are busy. People are busy.
You have to wait. But if I always tell them, like, if someone commits to want to give back, sure, when they have time, they would. No response. Please don't put her under pressure. If you say hi, if she answers, God be the glory. If you don't say, if you don't say anything, so God be the glory. Google, just
yes.
Type.
So please, they should. When you're sending a message, so I could just get to them faster. When they're sending messages, you should just say, "Hey, I'm from Dr. Noya's channel. You're going to get a response from me as soon as I can."
My name. Right. I want to ask. So someone is thinking, why residency in Nigeria?
When, okay.
Like, if this is so exciting about in Nigeria, what? Why don't I go to someone like US, Australia,
UK?
So, why would someone really choose to do residency in Nigeria when, let's say, I have other opportunities? Why would I choose? Okay. What are the benefits?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so one of the major benefits is that cost-wise, it's easier. Mm-hmm. To get mm-hmm. into cost-wise, because unless you have family in whatever country you're going to, it's not mm-hmm. going to be so easy cost-wise. So you know that you're in Nigeria, you have your family, everybody is here, you don't have to spend so much. So cost-wise, it's easier. Mm-hmm. But then if the other options out there, they mm-hmm. are much better, please consider it. But then don't consider it because your friends are doing it. You know, like mm-hmm. you said, there's this current trend, JAPA. So mm-hmm. even people that don't like clinical medicine are looking forward to going to become MOs in the UK because their friends are going. They want to take picture, winter jacket and everything. I know, as fun as mm-hmm. it may seem, you mm-hmm. you don't want to go there and end up being frustrated. Being frustrated in a foreign land, I always tell people, I say it's different from being frustrated in your foreign land. You will not exactly. understand the frustration until you get there and it hits you. So the truth mm-hmm. is this, even after doing your residency program, now here's the interesting thing, even after doing your residency program here in Nigeria, you can mm-hmm. always leave. Now, mm-hmm. if your teaching hospital or federal medical center happens to be accredited with the West African College of Physicians, which covers mm-hmm. hospitals in all institutions in West Africa, you mm-hmm. could easily go work anywhere else within the West African country. Mm-hmm. All you have to do most likely might be to just write their licensing exam to permit you to work as a foreigner in their country. But then, based mm-hmm. on the specialization part, you already have that. And mm-hmm. then there are also some places, some countries in the UK and also some countries around the world. Just have to find out which one that you can mm-hmm. go. You might need to just need to write one or two exams, but they will recognize you as a specialist. So that's the beauty of the West African College.
Oh, that's good. So
So you're not just going there as a typical medical officer. No, your specialist mm-hmm. training is coming into play as well.
So how easy is it to get into a West African accredited
Okay, for now, no, it's in every hospital that does residency training, either they have the West Africa accreditation or the nationals. Mm-hmm. My hospital currently has the West Africa accreditation. Most mm-hmm. hospitals have West Africa and national at the same time, so you're going to be running both programs simultaneously at the same time, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
I feel like most majority have the West Africa.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And even those that have just national, while you're mm-hmm. there, even within the 1 year or so, because they're always working towards it, because it gives you a broader mm-hmm. option. Yeah, so it's not really a problem.
Wow. I feel like this video is already too packed. I don't want to make it much more longer than this. I am definitely getting back. Before I let you go, thank you so much. So what are your final words? Everyone, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so take it one day at a time. Mm-hmm. I know some folks who started discovering themselves in residency. Mm-hmm. As interesting as that may seem, some people actually started doing residency midway, and after they pass maybe their part one, they're like, no, I don't want to be here. I want to be here. So it's fine. Mm-hmm. Don't put your at every point in time, please don't put yourself under pressure. Your folks mm-hmm. might seem like, oh, I finished with this person and this person is here bringing in big figures. That's their life. This is your life. try to always mm-hmm. focus on what you have going on for you. And even though it seems little, you have so much time to catch up. Never be in a hurry. Never put yourself under pressure. Don't ever join the bad wagon. So you won't get somewhere and start feeling frustrated. Take your time. Figure out yourself. Talk with people. Try out the pros and the cons, whatever it takes, so that at the end of the day, when you get to a particular point, you know that this is where you've always wanted to be. And even when it is stressful, because this is where you want to be, you are going to complain, but you're enjoying the stress to some extent.
I get it.
So thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Thanks so much for being here. I think this is such an amazing... I wish, sometimes I'm like, I'm so jealous of people. I wish that I think there were those videos. I just didn't just look for them. So I wish I focused on those things like Ellie, but good enough you were there anyway. So that I read your book. Thanks so much. Thanks so much. As for book, you first was with book that time. You know, you're not going to fake on.
And it showed. You guys were passing in flying colors.
yes. Well done for that. And I really appreciate publicly. Okay.
You're welcome.
I think you gave the best advice, not just for medicine. I think that's the best. Mm-hmm. I think if you ask me one thing I learned the year before 2021, take one day at a time. That's life. Yeah. Like, yes, don't join the crowd, just take one day at a time. Thank you everyone for watching. Please, if you have questions, she already told you, you see my name is already going, just put from this channel, and then she's gonna give you all the answers and questions and everything. She's a big book too, you can ask her. Small
these days.
Which small these days? I'm sorry, don't reach like this. Thank you so much. There are a lot of challenges in the medical field in Nigeria, but this 2022, especially in January, I am just looking forward to interviewing doctors who just share the bright light, so that this channel just all be so gloomy and every other thing.
The bright
last, there are some doctors who would never leave Nigeria. Because trust me.
Yes. This thing we are in. You just have to know. Okay, let me share this one. Mm-hmm. I have this colleague. Yeah, we're looking for the whole residency together. In fact, we met when we were preparing for the exam. So we passed together. In fact, he even came to my center. He didn't get a placement. And in nursing, I'm like, dude, what's up? What are you up to? I was like, well, I've started my clinic. I'm like, and dude is always busy. Is he not doing one surgery, doing this? He's cashing in big, his own private place. You get his cashing in big. So yeah, not everybody is going to do. So you just need to know what you want to do. Take your time, ask questions. Don't be afraid to ask questions. Mm-hmm. If you didn't get the right answer, ask more questions. You get it more somewhere. Questions. Yeah, you get it somewhere. Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much. Do like, share, subscribe to this channel.
Yes. Do all of that.
And I'm your plug. I'll be bringing all the medical superstars here, and hopefully watch more videos after this one. Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.